Welcome to my talk about nanobubbles and Langmuir layers. First, I want to give you a motivation of the work. So I am from the flotation group. And what is flotation? Flotation is a process to separate fine mineral particles and based on the different wettability of those minerals. So it's a heterocoagulation process. And that's quite special about flotation because you are actually able to tune this wettability by using different surfactants, for example, collectors. And by this, you can tune the wettability of your surface and therefore your separation property, what is not the case, for example, for a density separation. And the overall process is also pretty much influenced by different phenomena and different interfaces. So for example, the interaction of your frother molecules and the gas-liquid interface that are used to actually get a finer bubble size distribution and therefore increase the efficiency of your process. Or actually, as I already mentioned, the use of collector molecules to tune the wettability. And actually, a quite nice tool to investigate surfactants in interfaces is the Langmuir Blotchet trough. With this, you can, on the one hand, investigate surfactant molecules in the liquid air interface, and on the other side, you can investigate in surfactant molecules on solid substrates, so in the solid air interface or solid liquid interface, if you would measure, for example, in liquid mode. But there is one big limitation that is also quite crucial for flotation. You always have to use surfactants that are unsoluble in water. That's quite a big limitation actually for flotation reagents. So how does a Langmuir-Blotchet technique work? You basically have a trough where you give in your subphase, what is normally water. And on this subphase, you are spreading your surfactant molecules, normally in a solvent, in a nonpolar solvent like trichloromethane or hexane. And then you let the solvent evaporate, and you have just the surfactant molecules on your interface. And then you can start basically by pressing the barriers together. You can start to compress your surfactant molecules in your interface and build up a monolayer. During doing that, you're measuring the surface pressure with the Wilhelmy plate normally. And if you want to further deposit your surfactant layer on a solid substrate, you can place the substrate, for example, already in the subphase. And there are then further deposition types that you can use depending on the direction from which you are putting your substrate into the interface. So if you are coming from the bottom, you would get your polar head groups on the solid subphase and the hydrophobic chain groups basically directing into the environment. And if you're coming from the from the top, you get the opposite. So you would deposit the film with the hydrophobic chain groups directed to your substrate. How can this be maybe related to flotation? So basically, the structures of such Langmuir layers that are deposited on solid substrates. They are basically influenced by the environmental conditions as pH and electrolyte concentrations and different electrolytes. So example, in this picture, you can see CTEP molecules on a silica phase with a scanning rate of 300 nanonewtons, 300 nanometers in a scanning area. On the one side, it's only CTEP molecules, and on the other side, there is potassium bromide added into the phase. Those layers weren't deposited with the Langmuir technique. They just adsorbed in the bulk phase and then were investigated with the AFM. But also, when you're actually using the Langmuir throw to deposit stearic acid molecules, and you're using different electrolytes, you can also get different structures. For example, calcium ions would have a more stabilizing effect, but also producing those small holes. And if you would use potassium ions, then you would really destabilize your monolayer. And yeah, actually our goal would be to correlate different structures of adsorbed surfactant molecule layers with a flotation performance, and for example also with the abundance of nanobubbles, because actually such structures as in this case could be favor a nucleation of nanobubbles on your mineral surface. And then you could also test that for different minerals, and you could maybe track also a bit the selectivity of your process. And it just would be maybe an option to get a better understanding and more detailed understanding of what's actually going on in flotation. So the procedure that we used so far is basically to deposit our layers of stearic acid. Stearic acid is a quite already really, really well investigated model surfactant, and that we also started to use to evaluate our methodology. And we deposited on freshly cleaved mica slides, and then did investigations via the AFM technique in tapping mode, and then also did contact angle measurements just to evaluate what we are actually seeing under or with the AFM. And yeah, that's for this slide. So when we started, we just wanted to make sure first that actually our Langmuir throw is running right, and that we are able to get a reproducible layer of stearic acid on our mica surface. And what you can see here basically is a Langmuir isotherm. So when you have your stearic acid molecules in your interface, and you start to press them together. So on the y-axis, you have the surface pressure measured by the Wilhelmy plate. On the x-axis, you have the mean molecular area of your stearic acid on the interface. And when you start to actually compress your molecules, you're still in a gas-like state where the molecules in the interface don't really interact with each other. And if you compress further, you're getting into a liquid-like state where actually the molecules start to interact with each other, but they are not really compacted right now. And if you further compress, you really get into a solid state where you actually got a monolayer of your surfactant, and you are even able to rupture your monolayer again if you further increase the surface pressure. And stearic acid is quite nice because it gives you distinct features in the isotherm that can be used as a kind of quality criteria of your process. So that's basically the maximum surface pressure of around 50 to 60 millinewton per meter, and what is located at a mean molecular area of around 90 to 20 angstrom. Also the phase transition from the gas-like state into the liquid-like state at around 23 to 25 square angstrom. And if you then further deposit those layers on mica and investigate them via the AFM, we obtained the following. In the first row, you can see the topography, the phase signal, and the height profile. And we see a quite really smooth surface. We got some surface features, but they are only 0.6 nanometers in depth. And normally, an stearic acid molecule has a height around 2 nanometers. So it cannot be just a hole in the stearic acid layer. And we are still not really sure what it is. It's just some kind of surface defect. When we deposit another layer on this layer, We are not getting a smooth layer anymore. We are forming islands, and they are looking basically, yeah, like this. But we can also see those islands in the phase signal. So we are thinking that it's islands of stearic acid molecule showing with their polar head group in our direction, basically. And on a first really homogeneous layer of stearic acid molecules. And when we repeat the procedure and we deposit a third layer, that was, I think the most interesting part for me is actually then we can see different areas. One area where we have features that are actually have a height around 5 nanometers. What does not really fit well to a feature of stearic acid molecules on already an homogeneous stearic acid molecule layer. So basically, normally the feature should be around 4 nanometers height, so we have 1 nanometer more, that's still discussable. But we also have features here, for example, in this green area that are only around 2 nanometers height, so that's basically an island of stearic acid molecules on the smooth surface of stearic acid. And the interesting thing is we can distinguish between the one layer or the second layer also in the phase signal, but the third layer that is like 2 additional stearic acid molecules in height, we cannot see in the phase signal. And meaning basically that you can distinguish between the head groups and the hydrophobic tail groups of your stearic acid molecules via the phase signal. And why are we sure actually that we are seeing here in this case really an stearic acid layer? So we did contact angle measurements, and when you basically measure the contact angle on a pure mica substrate, you won't be able to measure any contact angle. Any contact angle, there would be a complete spreading of your drop. And if you measure on this surface, you actually are able to achieve a contact angle. The problem is that it's quite unstable. So when you do the contact angle measurement, the droplet gives you a contact angle around 90 degrees, but you are not really able to capture this contact angle because it immediately starts to decrease. And you're not really, or it's quite hard to start the measurement just in time to capture this first contact angle. And it actually shows that the droplet is just solving the stearic acid again from your mica surface. And basically, the longer you're waiting, the lower your contact angle gets. And I would say that you will most probably end up really with low contact angles again. But we can see that we have an hydrophobicity or an increased hydrophobicity at the beginning, really showing us that we deposited something on our mica substrate. And when we are adding calcium ions, we can basically see the same effect as in this publication. We are also here still off with the height information. So normally it should be 2 nanometers high in height. And yeah, we are having a height of around 4 nanometers. I'm not really sure where this comes from. It could be that it's from wrong AFM parameters. The others were basically, the other substrates I showed, they were measured in dry environment. Why in a dry environment? Just because we already knew from the contact angle measurements that the films are not stable, so there was not really a case to measure those layers in a wet environment when they get solved anyhow. But by using calcium ions, we know that it can have a stabilizing effect on the film. And that's the reason why we used those substrates also to measure in the liquid environment. And also to hopefully be able to detect nanobubbles on those substrates. What can be possible reasons maybe for the difference in the height to from 4 nanometers in height to 2 nanometers in height that we would have expected? It could be maybe an reorientation or restructuring of the molecules, maybe even a swelling of the layers, and that's still discussable. And also, what I have to admit, we tried to visualize nanobubbles on the structures, and we were actually quite sure that we could hopefully see bubbles on those structures, but we didn't achieve that goal yet. So we tried until also the methods where we used quite cold water with 5 degrees Celsius and increased the temperature to 20 degrees. But with this method, we weren't able to get any nanobubbles yet. And for the summary, so basically the Langmuir films that we deposited so far, they can be investigated quite well with the AFM. The structure can be influenced with different electrolytes. The porous structures that we are forming should favor a nucleation of nanobubbles, but that's what we are not able to prove yet. But our further plans for the future, for example, to make it even a bit more related maybe to mineral processing would be to not only use mica as a substrate. Once we maybe are a bit more able to handle the challenges of the deposition and the measurement of nanofilms on such substrates, we would also like to use thin sections of minerals. So in this case, we already produced a thin section of fluorite. By fluorite, because also the collectors you're using in fluorite flotations are insoluble in water. But we could also use like real ore samples, and then we could investigate them, for example, with MLA technique, and could investigate the thin sections under the AFN and hopefully see, for example, different structures on different mineral phases. To investigate more the selectivity of our process. So, thank you for your attention. And
thank you, Eddie. Have we any questions? Some of you? Yes?
Did you also measure the contact angles on the calcium stabilized films?
Yes, and they were more stable. But we didn't really, so what we actually wanted to see is the difference when we are using, for example, potassium ions in our subphase and calcium ions. And we saw that actually the contact angle with calcium ions was more stable than in milky water or within the potassium chloride solution. But actually, we didn't saw really an increasement of the contact angle in comparison to the milky water, just that it was more stable.
Yeah. What range of contact angles did you observe in that case? Because maybe this is simply not hydrophobic enough to create the nanobubbles.
It was always the first contact angle actually that we measured was always around 90 degrees. Mm, okay. But actually, as I said, also in the case of calcium ions, it decreased really fast to a certain value of, let's say, 40 to 50 degrees, and then it just stayed stable. That wasn't achieved with milky water so far, but also with calcium ions, we have a decrease in the contact angle, but then at a certain level, at least it stays stable.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you. Maybe we have time for one other question. If this is not the case. I guess the coal flotation community don't like your results, but it's okay. And because we are running just out of time, I would introduce the next speaker. Thanks, Eddie, again.